Good morning, church. Please forgive me. I'm like three minutes late, but it's okay. I got caught up back there, and I'm glad to be in the house of God this morning. Are you?
Amen.
This morning, you woke up to God's mercy. Are you thankful?
Yes.
Amen. You could have went home last night, but you're stuck down here with the rest of us until the Lord comes for us. And that's still a good thing, right? I know I didn't meet any first-time guests this morning. I do have any birthdays before I go any further. Jim's birthday again. I don't know why I shouldn't have said that, but happy birthday, Jim, again. Any anniversaries? Well, I have two anniversaries I'd like to announce. One, last week, my wife and I celebrated 2 years here. And I forgot to mention that. And we've been blessed with you all ever since. Also, the second anniversary I want to mention is this Tuesday. I got to get this right. Dads, husbands, I will be celebrating my 8th anniversary with my lovely bride. So if you don't see us here for a few days, we will be out of town. We'll be back Friday. Also, I want to welcome everybody this morning. We have a busy day today. It already started since early this morning at Sunday school. We also will be having a brief member business meeting after service. We will be affirming Mr. John Thompson, who's right there, raise your hand, John, as deacon, one of our deacons in the church. Also, we will be having a shared meal. How many here love shared meals? We get to fellowship with one another. Also, during the shared meals, Brother Charlie in the back, he's the guy with the nice smile, photos for the upcoming church directory. Make sure you smile for the directory. Make sure you fill out that form that he will be having. Also, tonight's service at 6 p.m., the mission of the church. We're going to finish that up, I believe, that one particular lesson. Let me remind the church, all you got to do is turn on the news and look at, or just know what's going on, not only just here in our state, but throughout the country as well as the world. We're in a big mess. Church, we need to be a praying people. If you would like to come out on Wednesday at 6 p.m., we will be praying for the community, the church community, everything around us, from leaders on down throughout the world, Israel, and so forth. Also, let me remind the ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, Thursday morning at 9:30 a.m., women's group downstairs, men upstairs. Did we get that right? Awesome. At this time, I'll turn it over to Rick.
Well, actually, this is a definite pleasure in the body of the church is when we get to welcome new members. Now, we have a new member to introduce to you this morning, and that's Kathy Slater. And I may well help assist in this matter. Well, yeah, just coming up here. I'm going to go down here and speak loudly since I want to hear down here with Kathy. But if you don't know her, you know, she's been kind of quiet around here for some time. But I'm sure this is going to be quite a blessing as she joins this body. First item would be to share with you the membership commitment. I'll read that now. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
That's interesting. Having been born again by the grace of God through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and being justified on the ground of his shed blood and having confessed my faith before men, I do now in the presence of God in this assembly most solemnly and joyfully enter into this commitment with my fellow members as one local portion of the body of Christ. I commit, therefore, by the power of the Holy Spirit, to walk in Christian love, to strive for the advance of the church in knowledge, holiness, and comfort, to promote its prosperity and spirituality, to sustain its worship, ordinances, disciplines, and doctrines, and to contribute cheerfully and regularly to the support of the ministry, the relief of its poor, and the spread of gospel to all nations. I also commit to maintain family and personal devotions, to educate my children in God's word, and Spirit. Now, for the congregation as well, do you also affirm and commit to the body of Christ, this membership with Kathy Slater this morning?
Amen.
Yes. Amen. Amen. Well, we have one more duty here. We have this official certificate here, suitable for framing. It's for, certifies it. Kathy, apparently she goes by it. Kathy, that's, anyway, we'll know her as Kathy. Kathy Slater has confessed Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, has been received into full membership of Bethany Bible Church on the 28th day of April, the year of our Lord, 2024. Amen. I'm going to have Heidi pray and pray for her this morning.
Leave with the church. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord God, for allowing us to gather this morning. You have been gracious and merciful to us, Lord God. And now, Father God, we present unto you, Lord God, our sister in faith, who has voluntarily committed herself into this particular body here at Bethany Bible. We ask, Father God, that you continue to move on her behalf. We ask, Father God, that your grace and mercy will follow her all the days of her life. We ask, Father God, that you continue to pour out that love and bestow it within her, deep within her heart, soul, and mind. We ask that, Father God, that you continue to move on her behalf, continue to bless her family, her husband, and all those behind her, Father. We thank you, we praise you, and all God's people said,
Amen.
This is for you.
Oh,
okay. I want to take that part.
Okay, have the music team. We're going to have a chance, opportunity to lift up our voices, praising to the thrice holy God. It's hymn number 41. Let's stand. Hymn number 41. We'll be singing the first three verses of Holy, Holy, Holy. Please remain standing afterwards. I've asked John Holman to come up and share scripture and verse following this hymn. Holy, Holy, Holy.
Family, church. I guess that's implied, huh? That church is all family. Reading of God's word today in the book of Ephesians, chapter 5. And in this section, Paul is speaking to the Ephesians and about the new life that they have in Christ, that they're no longer walking in darkness, that they are now walking in light. And I'm going to pick this up at verse 13. But when anything is exposed by light, it becomes visible. For anything that becomes visible is light. Therefore, it says, Awake, O sleeper, arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Look carefully, then, how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, which is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart. Give thanks always for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. The Word of God. Let's pray. Lord God, we come to you this morning with a desire in our heart to please you, a desire that you have given to us. In fact, you've instilled that in us. Without that, we wouldn't be here. Please help us this morning to worship you with a heart that is undistracted. You know how our minds wander to the things of the upcoming week, to the thoughts and worries of other things. Help us to put those thoughts away and focus on you and on your glory. And Lord, may our minds focus on the Word as Zach brings the message this morning. Father, we pray that you will work through him, that your Spirit would convict us, and that your Spirit will transform us into the people that you want us to be. That way, so that we would be hearers of the Word and not just we would be doers of the Word and not just hearers. And we ask these things in the name of Jesus, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. This next song is rather short, but it contains a truth that we owe God himself a great debt. And that debt we have in no way, nothing we could do, even if it's been an attorney, could we pay that back. But through Jesus Christ alone, he paid that debt for us. He paid a debt he did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. Next hymn, I know everyone should be very familiar with. It's titled, It Is Well With My Soul. If you know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, truly it is. No matter what trials and tribulations we go through, we have that assurance of an eternity with Christ. It is well with my soul. Let's stand with this one.
My lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well.
Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
We are going to be picking up our study of Colossians in Colossians chapter 2, verse 1. The goal is to get through verse 15 this morning. I did make sure to bring up my own water because, as John reminded me, Joe's gone this morning and he can't bring me one when I realize I don't have it. All right. So we did end a little bit short from where we intended last week. That's a little close to my face, isn't it? So we will be picking up at the very beginning of chapter 2, where we left off. And we will get back in to the mystery that has been revealed, and then what that mystery has resulted in Christ. Now again, if you guys don't remember, as we've been going through the book of Colossians, the main theme, the main issue that Paul seems to be dealing with is some kind of Greek philosophy, Greek dualism that has been infiltrating either the church in Colossae or in the regions around it, and he seems to be preemptively warding it off. He's giving warning that these concepts of Greek philosophy, where the spirit is inherently good and the physical world is inherently bad and we're trying to escape from it, he is kind of dealing with, like, hey, this isn't the gospel, and he's really rooted it so far in the reality of the incarnation, right? That Jesus, God, became man. He dwelt among us in the flesh and entered into the physical world, not that the physical world might be done away with, but rather that it can be reconciled and reclaimed by Christ, who is the last Adam. He's the one coming to do what the first Adam failed in. The first Adam was supposed to, according to Genesis 1, set up dominion. He was supposed to rule over the world with his descendants under him. And they were supposed to make the world fruitful. And they were supposed to claim it in this way as those made in the image of God. Now, Adam falls. This results in the corruption of the created order. And now, though, the last Adam, the one who is coming like Adam, he has come. He was dead, buried, resurrected, and now he is bearing fruit and multiplying in what Adam was supposed to do, and reclaiming and reconciling the world to himself, all to find its culmination and fullness that we'll see at the beginning of chapter 3 in the return of Christ bodily to this world. So the idea that the process has begun, it's a present reality, but the fullness of it comes ultimately at the return of Christ. So we've dealt with last week, at kind of in the closing, that there was a mystery that was unknown to the previous people of God, to the prophets, as things were revealed to them. It wasn't revealed fully. There was still mystery. There were things that were not understood. And now that mystery is revealed in Christ. That here is the Messiah who would be the suffering servant and the conquering king, who would set up his dominion and reconcile and bring in the Gentiles and do all. And now we see what God was intending. He kind of let us know that the Gentiles were going to come in. There was going to be reconciled. Things were going to be changed. New covenant. We get all that. We don't really see how it's going to happen. And now here's Paul going, it's happened. That mystery that was yet to be revealed is now revealed in the person of the Son, Christ Jesus, the God-man. So picking up in chapter 2, verse 1, we will be, the goal again is to go through verse 15. So if you guys will stand with me for the reading of God's word. Hear the words of the living God. For I want you to understand how great a struggle I have on your behalf and for those who are at Laodicea, for all those who have not seen my face in the flesh, so that their hearts may be encouraged, having been held together in love, even unto all the wealth of the full assurance of understanding, unto the full knowledge of God's mystery, that is, Christ himself, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. I say this so that no one will delude you with persuasive argument. For even though I am absent in body, nevertheless I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the stability of your faith in Christ. Therefore, as you received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, having been firmly rooted and being built up in him, and having been established in your faith, just as you were instructed, and abounding with thanksgiving. See to it that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deception, according to the tradition of men, according to the elementary principles of the world, and not according to Christ. For in him all the fullness of deity dwells bodily, and in him you have been filled, who is the head over all rule and authority, in whom you were also circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, in the removal of the body of the flesh, in the circumcision of Christ, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised up with him through faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead. And you being dead in your transgressions and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he made you alive with him, having graciously forgiven us all our transgressions, having canceled out the certificate of death of debt consisting of decrees against us, which was hostile to us. He has also taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross, having disarmed the rulers and authorities, he made a public display of them, having triumphed over them in him. Thus says the word of the living God. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your scriptures and for your church. May it testify to you and to your glory and your purposes, God. May we be built up, encouraged. May the gospel have its way among this people. May we be made aware of our reconciliation for those of us who are in you, and for those who are not, may that reconciliation be accomplished here practically. Father, may we be built up into the kind of people that are worthy of your gospel, that live according to your will. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 You may be seated. So, again, in verse 1, Paul says, "For I want you to understand how great a struggle I have on your behalf and for those who are at Laodicea and for all those who have not seen my face in the flesh." Now remember, as Paul speaks of his struggles, he is actively in prison, right? Colossians is one of the prison epistles. So along with Philippi, I would argue that Ephesians is also one of the prison epistles. Some disagree with that state, or at least to a degree, depending on certain timings of when things were written. But these epistles are being written while Paul is in prison for the gospel. I don't know if I just butchered my sentence right there or not. Paul writes this epistle as he is in prison for the preaching of the gospel and the proclamation of Christ's lordship. So Paul, as he speaks of his struggles, that's what's going on. He's struggling, okay? And typically in Paul's epistles, when he uses this word struggle, he's talking about struggling doctrinally. He's talking about that he's warring against doctrines, false teachings, philosophy, things working their way in. So as Paul is in prison, there's a labor and a struggle that is going on as he is preventing false teaching, as he is proclaiming the truth of the gospel. He's warring against Judaizers. He's warring against Greek philosophy, attempting to make inroads into the church. There is a battle going on, and Christian, you must be ready to fight the same kind of battle. Paul says that you are to be ready for all times to answer and give a defense for the hope that is within you. You must be ready. You must be prepared to answer these kinds of doctrinal issues that come up. That is your calling as well. Maybe not to the same degree as Paul's. Paul holds a unique position in apostolic authority and office and all of that. It's true. But that doesn't change that Peter gives that responsibility to all Christians, that you be ready to give a defense of the faith and the hope that is within you. And to do so, you must know the scriptures. If you do not know the scriptures, you will not be able to answer this calling. You will not be able to answer when false teachers come in the door, when those who pervert the gospel show their face and proclaim their lies. You won't be ready to answer them. You won't be ready to struggle and fight the way Paul does, the way Peter says you ought to at all times. You must be in the Word. I mean, we see this even as here, while we don't have a lot of, as we've gone through Colossians so far, while we don't have a lot of direct quotes of the Old Testament, we've gone through how often, right, Paul has been alluding to the Old Testament in the background, that he's been particularly using language to call back to the idea of the temple, the idea of the last Adam. He's bringing scripture to mind and saying, don't forget these things. And his whole argument has been based in the reality of what God has been doing since creation and working his way forward. So you, Christian, must be ready to give an answer according to the Word. Also, it's an important and always interesting to take note here, last thing about verse 1 anyways, that this laboring that Paul's doing is for those he has not seen in the flesh. He's never actually met these people. Remember, we go to verse 1, they received the gospel from Epaphras. That's who came to Colossae and proclaimed the gospel to them. That's who built up the church in Colossae to begin with. That's who God used. And yet Paul's here as an apostle is writing in and say, even though I haven't been there with you, what has he told them so far? I'm thankful for you. I've heard your love and your faith and your hope testified of. Praise God for it. Don't walk away from what was given to you from Epaphras. And we'll see it again here in a second. So this love that Paul has is extending out to all of the church, even those who he hasn't personally preached the gospel to and met. Now verses 2 and 3. What is this laboring for? So that their hearts may be encouraged, having been held together in love, even unto all the wealth of the full assurance of understanding, unto the full knowledge of God's mystery, that is Christ himself, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. So heart here, when it talks about so that their hearts may be encouraged, I like the way G.K. Beale kind of references this in his commentary, is that the heart is a typical Old and New Testament way of kind of talking about the spiritual center of a person. I thought that was a good wording of it. That heart, we're not specifically talking about the physical organ of the heart, but rather that the heart is kind of this center way in which the New Testament testifies to you as a person, like the undergirding spiritual reality. That is to be encouraged here. Like I want to, at the very depths of the spiritual reality of how God made you, on my labor that you may be encouraged, be held together in love. So this encouraging leads to the people being held together. There is a unity that comes from doctrinal purity. There's a unity that comes from of standing in the truths of the scriptures and sound doctrine. There's a unity that comes along with that. You see, oftentimes it is the ones who stand by the truth of scripture and say, no, there's undergirding truths that the church has known from the scriptures throughout its history. We cannot depart from these key truths. And it's like, well, you're just being really divisive about this. No, the person who came in and is trying to corrupt the scriptures is the one being divisive. They're the ones who are sowing disunity among the body. The one who comes in and goes, well, is it really important that Jesus was God? Is it really important that Jesus came in the flesh? You know, like this whole issue of, you know, salvation, how much does it really matter? No, get out. You are the one who's sowing disunity among God's people. Martin Luther, a great Martin Luther quote on the subject was, peace if possible, but truth at all costs. Like desiring to have peace among all men, but ultimately truth must be stood on, and truth is worth fighting and struggling for. And it's in that struggle that we may come into unity. Now, it is important to note, as I say this, you don't want to get wrapped up in issues that don't hold the same weight as certain other issues. Okay? Who the Nephilim were particularly is not on the same level as the doctrine of the Trinity. You feel me? Like there is levels to this. It doesn't all equate to the same thing. Now, that doesn't mean that some of these discussions aren't important. Discussions of biblical framework, discussions of baptism, which, I mean, is hugely important. discussions of end time. Like, these things do in fact matter. They just don't matter as, say, such as we are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. You guys get what I'm saying here? Like, we do have to understand there are core central issues, that these are the things we stand on. These are the things that we, these are the hills that we die on. The inspiration of Scripture, that God, that we are saved by grace alone through faith alone. The triune nature of God, that the one being of God exists in three persons who are co-equal and co-eternal with one another. Like, these things matter, and we have to die on these hills. We don't die on, because I think the Nephilim's a really good example. That's not the hill to die on. And I have strong opinions about the Nephilim. I say that being like, I've looked into the issue, and I think I know something about, like, I think the Bible says something about this. I'm like, I will sit up here and be like, yes, fallen spiritual beings laid with women, and the result was giant children. And I think we see them testified throughout history, and people like Hercules, like demigod, like these demigod figures that exist. Like, I think that's what's going on in Genesis. You're allowed to disagree with me on this. You don't, I'll have a fun discussion with you about it. Like, and I will enjoy the discussion. But it's not the same thing as the Trinity. Now, this unity that comes with assurance for the soul, that is rooted in the knowledge of the mystery, and that mystery, it tells us here, is Christ himself. And this is not that the coming of the Christ was unknown, or that everything about his work wasn't revealed. Again, the fact that Messiah is coming, he would be a king, he would bring in the Gentiles, his reign would extend all across the globe. All these things are testified of in the Old Testament. Particularities were not made abundantly clear, and were not until Christ came and fulfilled the things and said, took his apostles in and said, okay, look, let me explain to you the prophets. Let me, in case you're still not getting all of it here, let me show it to you. Let the Spirit testify to it. May it now all be fully understood what the prophets meant, the things that they wish they had seen with their own eyes, you get to see. And you got to see it play out. Now proclaim it. And again, we talked about this last week, but this is an important issue. If you only read the New Testament, you will fail. You will eventually cease to understand the New Testament. If you don't read the Old Testament, if you forsake, like, the New Testament's going to stop making sense, because you're going to come to a passage like this and be like, why are you talking about a mystery? And you'll see people who do this, who end up coming up with crazy ideas about what the mystery is Paul's talking about. And it's because they have no concept of the changing of the guard from the old covenant to the new covenant that happened. That, okay, there was a way thing was going on. Christ came and changed everything. New covenant. And now mystery's been revealed. And if you don't realize, because if you read just the Old Testament, it should be very plain and obvious to you. Like, if that's all you were given. This is the way I heard someone put it recently. Like, you would come back with it and go, well, where's part two? Where's the sequel? Because this obviously isn't finished yet. There's more to come. Where's the rest? Where's the rest of the explanation of it? And that's what the New Testament is. But if you don't have the old, and if you're not putting yourself constantly within the Old Testament, then when you come to the new, it's not really going to come together the way it should. And you're going to end up with these weird, disjointed concepts of the new covenant or New Testament, because you have failed to understand what God previously revealed and what that new covenant was being built on. You guys get me? Now, in this Christ, in this mystery, are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Now, I do think that in these few verses, we do have another Old Testament allusion here. In the language being used, I believe Paul has in mind here Proverbs chapter 2, verses 3 through 6. It says there, for if you call out for understanding, give your voice For if you call out for understanding, give your voice for discernment. If you seek her as silver and search for her as for hidden treasures, then you will understand the fear of Yahweh and find the knowledge of God. For Yahweh gives wisdom, from his mouth come knowledge and discernment. And so you see, when we get to the, if again you use the Greek Septuagint, where, if you don't remember what the Greek Septuagint was, it would have been the Bible of the early church, of the church of this time. It was the Old Testament translated into Greek. And so when you, a lot of the time when you have, so that's where we get a lot of this, and we start to recognize Old Testament allusion in the New, because you have the Greek Septuagint that they would have been using, and they start using the same language of the Septuagint in the New Testament. So the same Greek that was used to translate from Proverbs is being used again by Paul here in verses 2 and 3. He's reiterating that, this concept that there was a God who gives discernment, that there's hidden treasures, that there's knowledge and wisdom that needs to be sought out. And here is Paul saying, it's in Christ. That's where you find it. All the wisdom, all that knowledge, all this stuff that Solomon back in the Proverbs was saying, seek these things out, you'll find them in Christ. And this circles back to what we talked about last week with being reason, logic, knowledge, and wisdom. They're only possible because of Christ. Because Christ is the creator, as we saw in Colossians 2, chapter 1, Christ is the one who ordered the cosmos. He set it into place. He created it ex nihilo, out of nothing. All of it is rooted in him. So none of it makes sense apart from him. You can't appeal to logic and reason once you deny the reality of the triune God of Scripture, because none of it's actually going to make sense. You can't be an atheist and go, well, you know, like everything's just random and a result of chance acting on matter, and none of it actually has any, and, you know, it's all just, I mean, essentially the claim here is that it's all nonsense. And why should you trust the chemical, if it's all just material in this way, why should you trust the chemical firings happening in your head and expect that they're actually telling you the truth and when it comes to reality? Why should they properly relate to anything? There's nothing ordering them. It's all just an accident. There's no way you can trust any of it. What are laws of nature? Why do they sit there? Why haven't they changed? You can look at this at the philosopher David Hume, who was an atheist, who spoke of the problem of uniformity in nature. And he goes, just because a fire burned me today doesn't give me any reason to justify that it will burn me tomorrow. I don't have any actual reason to stand here and say that the laws aren't going to change, because nothing's holding them up. They're just here, and there's nothing that sustains them. So how could I justify that what's true today is going to be true tomorrow, that I actually understand any of this and that my brain works right and I'm not just and we're all not just crazy? You have no justification for morality. You have no justification for reason. None of it. Once you start denying the simple truth that Christ is the creator and that the triune God governs and maintains the universe which he spoke into existence. And then this all brings us to verse 4. I say this so that no one will delude you with persuasive argument. Now, we're going to continue in this theme here, but this all this knowledge and wisdom and truth that's found in Christ, it's laid down and will ultimately, when it's grasped, when it's held onto, when you're rooted and grounded in it, it will not allow persuasive argument to overtake you. It will not. It is a bedrock against the false teaching. It is a bedrock against the emptiness that comes from this world. Because verse 5, Paul says, for even though I am absent in body, nevertheless I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the stability of your faith in Christ. Now again, it's verses like this that makes me think that the false teaching that Paul is dealing with hasn't actively made its way into the church in Colossae yet. Because he talks about his thankfulness for their stability, for the good order. This seems more like in preparation. That he's preparing them, like, hey, there's some stuff on the outskirts. You need to be ready for it. Because right now, I'm thankful for your good order and your stability. And I believe that this comment of order is in reference to them being doctrinally grounded. That there's truths that they have received again from Epaphras that they have not abandoned yet. Now, verse 6, therefore, as you received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him. So remember, this is a gospel, as we've already stated here. This is a gospel that's been preached to them, truths about Christ proclaimed, and as they receive these truths, they are to walk in them. Because the truth, what you believe about these, I mean, A.W. Tozer, I don't have it in my notes, A.W. Tozer's, one of his famous quotes was, the most important thing about you is what you believe about God. Because what you believe about the ultimate authority is going to be the ultimate dictator on, and I don't mean dictator like tyrant, I mean it's going to dictate how you live your life. What you believe about God is going to affect how you live every day. If you believe God doesn't care about something, you are going to live like God doesn't care about it, because why should you? If you believe God does, you're going to live like God does care about it, because you believe he does. You tracking with me? So as they have received Christ, that is how they are to walk. Now again, when you have a concept of dualism, and we're really going to get into this next week, but when you have this concept of dualism that makes its way into Christianity, this idea that the spiritual is inherently good and the physical is inherently bad, which is a problem that has plagued the church for 2,000 years, not necessarily to the same degrees every time, but it tends to come back a lot, where people like, well, like just physical things are bad, I want to stay away and I need to deny myself all this stuff because like it's physical. And I need to get up to the 39th dimension, up into some higher plane where things are really spiritual and therefore they're good. When you do that, you live like that. And that's how you get these, you get groups like the monastic orders and the desert monks that happened early, you know, fairly early in the church, and monastic orders that went to they were like, well, we're never going to get married and we're going to eat only really bad food. I'm only going to sleep 2 hours a day. In some extreme cases, you have guys who are like whipping themselves to try to purge the flesh. I mean, really like twisted stuff. But this is what happens when you don't accept the reality that the incarnate one, God himself, entered into his creation in a physical body in order to reclaim it. Of course you're going to live like the physical world, something that you need to escape from. Of course you're going to do nonsense like this. You're going to live some kind of extreme asceticism that does nothing but damage you and the church and has, as we'll see next week, no eternal value. No benefit spiritually whatsoever. But that's how you end up living. Now, how is it that they received Jesus? They received Christ Jesus, the Lord. So Christ is, you know, the New Testament. It's the Greek term for Messiah. It's the same concept when Old Testament talks about the Messiah. That's what the Christ means. So we're carrying that. Like, this is the Messiah, the Lord. So that word Lord kind of carries multiple weights to it that we have to understand. First, that Greek word Lord would have been the word used in the Greek Septuagint to put into the place of the name of God, Yahweh. So when the name of God, Yahweh, is used in the Old Testament, when the Greeks, when it's translated into Greek, they use the term Kyrios, Lord. And then, you know, many tradition that's kind of traditionally maintained itself, or even in, you know, many translations today, when you have your Old Testament, you'll see Lord in all caps, and it's there in the place of the name of God, Yahweh. So, and this is even a term that the Greeks would have used for their deities. So, using the term Lord here is a claim of to the deity of Christ being asserted. It's absolutely, this is the God-man. In the flesh, come to us. Here he is. And this is, you know, some of the issues you have in, at times, in, say, the Gospels with Jesus, right? Where they say, well, being a man, he makes himself out to be God. That's why we're trying to stone him. That's why we're trying to kill him. There's that aspect that goes on because they understood the claims he was making about himself. You know, when Jesus gets up and tells the Pharisees, before Abraham was, I am, when the I am statements of Christ, ego eimi, I am, in the Greek it's ego eimi. This term is, again, this is a reference to the name of God in the Old Testament, that Yahweh was the one, he's I am who I am, according to Moses, right? And so Jesus stands up, says, before Abraham was, I am. Here come the Pharisees immediately grabbing stones to stone him. Why? They understood his claim. They understood him standing up there and saying, I am your God. Whoo! Now, the secondary aspect of the claim, Lord, because while Lord, this word is used to describe deities, it is also used to describe human rulers like Caesar. So in particular, Caesar is Lord. If you're unfamiliar with some of the early church history, one of the main reasons, because it takes about 30 years after Christ before the Romans really get in on the persecuting Christians game. Like, before that, it's pretty much the Jews going after them, and sometimes Jews rile up Greeks, and there's some local issues that pop up in terms of, like, you know, Greeks and stuff getting, but the Roman Empire as, like, as an institution isn't really all that interested in what's going on with this Christian stuff. In fact, most of the time you have Pilate who's like, I don't understand why this guy's here. Or you have Festus later with Paul, where it's like, well, if you didn't appeal to Caesar, I would have just let you go because these Jews who brought you to me have no claim against you whatsoever, and I'm not sure what's going on here. But there was a claim that the Jews always brought, and it's what actually ends up becoming the issue. Because what the Christians end up refusing to say in the history of the church is they will not say that Caesar is Lord. And they won't say it because Jesus is Lord. They won't participate in the offering of incense on the altar to Caesar. This is why persecution against the Christians line up. Not because they worshiped another deity. There was all kinds of deities being worshiped in the Roman Empire. Just the reality of that you claim to God isn't the main problem. The problem is that you're saying your claims of your God are superseding the claims of Caesar, therefore you must die. So there is also the sense in which this claim of lordship is, in a way, a political claim. John 19, verses 14 and 15. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. And he, this being Pilate, said to the Jews, behold your king, pointing to Christ. So they cried out, away with him, away with him, crucify him. Pilate said to them, shall I crucify your king? The chief priests answered, we have no king but Caesar. So what happened? The king of the Jews came. The Jews rejected him and said, no, give us Caesar. That's our king. Right, this is political in this sense, right? These are political claims going on. No, Jesus is not king. Jesus is not Lord. Caesar is. And this Christians have been doing this for 2,000 years now. And this is why Christians who live like it and mean it are impossible to be ruled over by tyrants. That's why tyrants always end up coming against the church. John Knox, the Scottish reformer, who my youngest son is named after, the reason that the Protestant Reformation took over the nation of Scotland, that the doctrines of grace rang throughout that country and was heralded for centuries there. John Knox is a powerful man. He preached that resistance to tyranny is obedience to God. I mean, that's his quote. Resistance to tyranny is obedience to God. And this is because a tyrant who takes on for himself, which is what I'll argue a tyrant inherently is, a tyrant is one who takes on himself the role of deity and tries to impose his rule onto a people unjustly, in which way God has not established governments to operate when you look at the biblical text. I believe tyrant is a term I can defend biblically. And if you don't think you can defend it biblically, you shouldn't use the word. But it is clearly, I would say, a biblical concept, tyranny. We see it played out oftentimes where rulers are being unjust in a certain area and they are called to account by the prophets, by the scriptures, over and over again. And so Christians historically have been the enemy of tyrants because they won't bow the knee. Like, they just won't. They're like, no, you don't have the right. So some examples of this, and this stuff has really become clear more and more so. Christians modernly have really had to start thinking about this over the last 5 years, where the government started making decrees like, hey, actually, you can't gather. And the church is really confused because they haven't had to deal with stuff like this for a while. It's like, well, does the government get to tell us that? And eventually, I think a lot of the church has come to the realization of like, oh, they don't get to tell us that. They don't have that right. And you have men who fought it. So you have issues in Southern California, stuff that went through the court system. You had people who were arrested in Idaho who went through the court system and had this for singing psalms. You have this in Canada where men are arrested and then eventually were being kept from their family's visitation because they wouldn't close their church doors. Like if the church started to wake up over the course of this time, some from the very beginning, others it took a while. But there was kind of this thing like, hey, wait a second, the claims of the government only get to go so far and they don't get to usurp the Almighty. Now, I think there's a sense of clarity that's important here. It's important to state that the church as an institution is not a political organization. The church, and what I mean by that is there's an institution, the church. This institution's job is not to run civil governments. It is not to rule over people. It's not to have armies. It's not to punish criminals. The church doesn't do that right. The church exercises church discipline. It deals with spiritual needs and the preaching of the gospel. It does these kinds of things. But there, as individuals who make up the church, we do, in fact, have duties and responsibilities and callings when it comes to the political realm. You do have that. Like, so you see this as when a Christian, you have a country that's majority Christian, and now all of a sudden you have rulers in that government. They have a duty to rule in such a way as it would be honoring to Christ. Amen? Like, if you are a Christian holding a kind of position, your duty is to honor Christ in it. And that is true. You have a duty as a Christian in a land where you get to vote in such a way that honors God. Like that, you have a duty and an obligation. This isn't a neutral zone because Christ is Lord. And so there's no such thing as a neutral area because the claims of Christ's lordship extend to all areas of creation. So again, is the church meant to be a governing force? No. In the realm of politics, is there a way to act like a Christian? Yes. And the Christians doing it has historically gotten them in a lot of trouble. But it's also led into certain areas where, you know, like you have in the United States, where the Supreme Court is initially passing law, you know, when the Supreme Court rulings are being held and the Supreme Court justices are quoting the scriptures and Old Testament law in defense of their rulings, you ended up with a country that was, while not definitely not perfect, more just than many, really any nation that came prior to it. And now, it got better in some ways and it's gotten worse in others. And it's getting worse as we have more and more so denied the reality of the God through whom our rights are given to us. And because of that God has been denied, what you have is tyrants coming up who saying, we're the ultimate authority. We stand in the place of God. But to them, Christ is Lord, and resistance to tyranny is obedience to God. Now, verse 7. Having been firmly rooted and being built up in him and having been established in your faith, just as you were instructed and abounding with thanksgiving. Now, I believe the word root here that's being happened is a reference to what we've already had in the dominion mandate of Genesis chapter 1, that there's an idea of this kind of agricultural kind of language that they are to bear fruit and multiply. So you have this sense in which they are to have they've been firmly rooted, but they're also being built up, which I think is also a tie-in to the temple themes that Paul has also been playing with. So as they've received Christ Jesus the Lord, they are to walk in him, being firmly rooted and built up in him, having been established in their faith, just as they were instructed, and abounding with thanksgiving. So this instruction has come, they hold to it, and they operate in it and walk according to it. Verse 8, so that no one, see to it that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deception, according to the tradition of men, according to the elementary principles of the world, and not according to Christ. So this infusion of Hellenistic, of Greek philosophy that's been making its way into the church, that's been deceiving people seemingly in the areas around Colossae, needs to be abandoned. Right? People are being taken captive through reasoning for someone coming with this kind of reasoning that's not rooted in the scripture. It's not rooted in who Christ is. It's just, well, I have some theories about how the world works, and they're being taken captive. And you also have this happening according to the tradition of men. Now, when I see that tradition, I think what's happening again here, and we've talked about a little bit, is this Greek philosophy of dualism is kind of intermingling itself with Jewish tradition. We'll see that as we get in next week, as it seems how these false teachers are operating. And they're holding on to things that says like Sabbaths and dietary laws and all this kind of stuff. And it's kind of all getting wrapped into itself. And so you have this concept of Jewish customs and traditions that seem to be being latched onto by these heretics. Now, it is always the scriptures that we must bring to bear in order to correct any kind of conclusions that come from philosophy. So when you have errant philosophy bringing itself in and people are saying, well, you know, I have some theories about who God is based off Aristotle and some of his theories. And I think his, you know, metaphysic and philosophy was really good. So I'm going to take that Aristotle and I'm going to apply it to the doctrine of God. And I'm going to kind of start conforming myself into this. It's like, well, wait, does that line up with what the scriptures tell us about God? It's not that, like, we will all do philosophy. Like, you're all going to practice philosophy. It's philosophy in terms of the study of wisdom, the study of knowledge, all this kind of stuff. You're going to do it. It's inevitable. You will have a philosophy. The question is whether it's a biblical philosophy, whether it's grounded in what God has revealed to us. And if it's not, it needs to be corrected by Scripture and then abandoned. And our philosophy must be conformed into what God has revealed to us in Christ Jesus. The same thing also goes with the reality of any kind of traditions that we might have. I'm a big fan of tradition. I actually really like tradition. I love the creeds. I love the confessions. I love old school liturgy. Like, I love these things. There's things that the church has handed down to us that we should cherish and prize. But all tradition must be open to correction from the scriptures. We must be willing to examine our traditions and say, does this actually line up with what the scriptures tell us? Are my traditions good traditions or are they bad traditions? Do I have a good philosophy or do I have a bad philosophy? Compare it to what to Christ revealed in the scriptures, and that will answer those questions for you. We cannot impose our traditions and philosophies onto the biblical text and force the text to conform to them, but rather our philosophies and our traditions must be forced to conform to the reality of the scriptures. Now, verses 9 and 10. For in him all the fullness of deity dwells bodily, and in him you have been filled, who is the head over all rule and authority. So there's a reiteration here from the last chapter, which speaks, and it does in terms of in Christ Jesus dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. This idea was repeated from Colossians chapter 1. Now, there is, in the way we talked about this, this does testify to the deity of Christ. But again, what I think is even a little bit more so, and this comes to do with that word dwell here and the way it's used in the Greek, this is kind of reiterating the concept as Jesus as the new temple and us in him being built up into a temple. So in the way that the presence of God dwells in the temple, and that's what that word dwell, like the more literal way you could say this is, like when you get to John 1:14, is that the word became flesh and tabernacled among us. In the way that the tabernacle hosted the presence, you know, in the tabernacle was the presence of God. So in Christ is the presence of God as the temple of God. And as this temple, we are then being built up and filled with God. For those of us who are in union with Christ, we become the dwelling place of God, his temple. That is the way in which you are being built up. That is how we exist, that God does not, you know, in the way Jesus says to the woman of well, the day's coming when you're not going to worship God in this location or this location, but in spirit and in truth, where the dwelling place of God is going to be in his people. And so you have this, that in the fullness of the deity dwelling bodily in Christ, we being put in union with Christ are becoming this temple and being filled with the Spirit, being filled with the presence of God ourselves. In the church as a people is the temple of God where he dwells. You now have that kind of access, an access that wasn't there in the old covenant. A kind of direct relationship where you are a priest who gets to enter into the Holy of Holies rather than having others enter in for you. Now, this one with whom you are in union with, he is the head over all rule and authority. The one by whom you have been filled is the one to all answer, is the one that all must answer to, both material and spiritual. Matthew 28, verses 18 and 19 says, and Jesus came, and this is after the resurrection, before the ascension. Jesus says, Jesus spoke to them saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. So Jesus, at his resurrection, after his resurrection, before his ascension, says, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. It's all mine. He claims it immediately. I've conquered it. It's me. Now watch. And so he makes a claim to all these things. So these, he claims the authority over the spiritual realm and those who hold spiritual power, these fallen spiritual beings. Over them, he has all authority, but also over the nations, as we see in a place like Matthew 28. He has authority over them as well. There's nothing, again, outside of the lordship of Christ Jesus. Now, verses 11 and 12. In him, you were also circumcised with a circumcision made without hands and the removal of the body of the flesh in the circumcision of Christ, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised up with him through faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead. And we will probably stop here for the day. We won't get to the last couple verses I was intending to get to, but we'll pick up with that next week. But these last couple verses, 11 and 12, I do want to make up some points about. So these verses have been one of the primary ways that Protestants who believe that we should baptize infants have made their argument from, verses 11 and 12 here. And the way that argument is kind of made is that they look at this text and say, okay, you have circumcision, they connect it to in verse 11, they connect it to the baptism in verse 12, and they say in the same way that circumcision was given to the covenant people's children in the Old Testament, so in the New, we should give the sign of the covenant baptism to the children of those of the new covenant. The children of believers should receive baptism as a covenantal sign because like circumcision operated in the old, so baptism operates in the new. You guys get what I'm saying there? I'm not asking if you agree with me. I'm asking, do you get the argument? Because I don't agree with what I just said. I'm explaining to you the way certain men who I have great, great respect for and have been blessed by would argue for baptizing their children. They're newborn children, to be specific, apart from a confession of faith. So that's kind of, and this is really simplified. There's a lot of other stuff that goes into that, but that's kind of how the argument works here. So circumcision of Christ is baptism. In this baptism, we mark out our children as being members of the new covenant. It doesn't mean they're saved. It doesn't mean they're believers, but it does mean they're kind of part of the church here. That they're in this way in union with Christ, even if it doesn't mean their salvation at the end. It doesn't mean that they're the elect of God. It simply means that they're kind of part of this community. And so, and this is the same way, again, circumcision operates in the old, right? A Jewish boy would be circumcised. It marks him as a member of the old covenant. It doesn't mean that he would be a righteous man or be saved and see glory. So that's the argument. Now, I think there's a couple issues here, obviously. So in him, you were also circumcised with a circumcision made without hands and the removal of the body of the flesh and the circumcision of Christ. Now, there's a couple interesting things there. One is that I would argue that the circumcision of Christ, this circumcision, the way it's kind of being laid out here, is actually pointing to the death of Christ and the putting off of the flesh. So I think it's pointing to the fact that in Christ died, left his body, was resurrected. He puts off the old body, comes into a resurrected new body. And there's a sense here where then the circumcision is a spiritual reality that you're being brought into in the putting off of the old self and embracing the new one, right? The old man dies, the new one comes back. Now, one thing that's interesting about this is that when you look at these verses and it says the circumcision made without hands, so it's not physical in this sense, it's something being done by God. That phrase, made without hands in the New Testament, in every other situation it's used outside of Colossians, that phrase, it's talking about the temple. It's always talking about the temple. When you talk about the temple made without hands, it's something that is not being built up. You know, it's not being built by men up, but it's being built up by God. And here you have a circumcision made without hands. You look at Luke and you go, well, Jesus, according to the custom of the Jews, Jesus was circumcised in the temple. And was this a foreshadowing of what was going to come later in his putting off of the flesh in his death when he gives up his spirit? Now, I think it's... Now, in the removal of the body of flesh and putting to death the old man that happens in Christ... The putting off of this flesh in his death. So we have a spiritual reality in which we put off our flesh as we join into the death of Christ. We have been cut off from the old man. So in Christ's death, we join into this moment. But ultimately, it's a spiritual reality and something that's happening inwardly right now. Now, I think, therefore, the baptism that occurs then in verse 12, that we've been buried with him in baptism, isn't necessarily an immediate reference to physical baptism. I think it's the spiritual reality that we see played out here, that we've been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised up with him through faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead. So you have a spiritual reality, this spiritual kind of baptism, that physical baptism is meant to represent, in which you are buried with Christ and you are raised up with him through faith in the working of God. So you are alive in Christ through the work of Christ, through his death, burial, and resurrection. And in being raised up with him, we represent that in physical baptism. In the spiritual reality, which is being portrayed, I think, primarily by Paul here, we portray that physically in the sacrament of baptism. But I think this ultimately leads it to a point of being an argument for the Credo Baptist, and that what it is representing is something that has effectively happened, which is the salvation of a sinner, being buried and raised up to life. So I think it's a bad place where, you know, our Protestant brothers and sisters who believe in paedobaptism try to make the argument. You can go find some people online who strongly disagree with me, and you can go read what they have to say about that if you want. But that is what I believe is communicated there in verses 11 and 12. That's what the scriptures, I would say the Christian scriptures testify to. Now, next week, we will pick back up in verse 13. And the goal next week will be to finish chapter 2. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the scriptures. Thank you for that we may be built up and edified by them. Lord, I pray that... anything that was said this morning, Lord, that was not from you, may it be forgotten. But if anything that was stated that was true, may it take root in our hearts and mind and build us up and conform us further into the image of Christ. Thank you for your church, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us stand together. Short chorus. It's titled my tribute, but it's to give God the glory. To God be the glory for the things he has done. To remain firm as we struggle, Lord. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but it's against rulers, against powers, and against world forces of this darkness, Lord. Help us to remain firm, committed. As your word says, take up the full armor of God, but it's through your power. We thank you, Lord. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Just a quick reminder, we have fellowship meal following us, photos. And for the members, please remain for a moment. In about 5.5 minutes, we'll have a short business meeting. You are dismissed.